Okay, so thank you everyone for staying. Welcome to the Cantonese media panel. And because we are a media panel, we have to kind of mediatize it. So instead of doing our formal presentations, we're going to have a more kind of informal and open discussion. So the format will be I will spend about 10 minutes introducing the panel and also introducing the kind of themes and questions that I have for them. And then I'll ask them, each of them, to kind of respond from their own experience, their own expertise about the questions that I pose. And I'll moderate a discussion amongst us for maybe the first 30 minutes or so, and after that I will throw it all open for all of us to have a kind of discussion. So my name is Helen Leung. I'm an associate professor at Simon Fraser University. My main discipline is in film and cultural studies. So I'm really delighted to have a very distinguished panel, a very diverse panel of both media practitioners, educators, scholars, as well as artists. And just to let you see how distinguished they are, I'll give a brief introduction. Well, Zoe Lam needs no other introduction, but maybe this is a side of her you haven't heard yet. She's a PhD student, a PhD candidate at UBC Department of Linguistics, and her research focuses on speech perception by heritage Cantonese speakers in Vancouver. But she also was a collaborator in a multimedia art installation, and she's an active user of social media such as Facebook, Instagram, and everything else. So we'll hear a lot about that later. Next to her, Kenneth Tong is a member of the governance board of Kwantlen Polytechnic University. He's also the former chair of the board of directors at Success. He was recipient of the Queen's Diamond Jubilee Medal and also actually a lot of other distinctions. He has actually hosted popular Cantonese radio programs for many, many years and is currently a public affairs commentator at Fairchild Radio. Next to Kenneth is Karen Lee, who's an adjunct professor for film production in the Department of Theatre and Film at UBC. She's also the manager of the Rogers Multicultural Film Production Program, and she's an award-winning filmmaker. And if you Google her, you can find actually a lot of her works online. She was born and raised in Vancouver and is a fourth-generation Chinese-Canadian. And there's a really interesting fact. Her great-grandparents left Toisan and Sundak and settled in BC about 135 years ago. That's a great piece of history that I hope maybe will come up today in the discussion. Next to Karen is Gabriel Yu, and I'm sure a lot of you know Gabriel. That probably doesn't need too much introduction. Gabriel was born and educated in Hong Kong. He's an award-winning media commentator, community activist, political consultant, and a small business owner. And I love his flower shop downtown. And our last presenter is Liam Doherty. I actually met Liam in the Cantonese meetup group. So he's a PhD student in the modern language education at UBC. He researches on digital literacy, agency, socialization, and mobile technologies in Chinese language learning and use. So I'm I feel very privileged to be amongst this very accomplished and interesting panel. Now, I just want to kind of maybe set the stage a little bit and throw some questions at them. The questions that really came out of perhaps my own field, my own experience as a kind of film studies scholar being raised in Hong Kong, but then having lived most of my life away in European and North American country. So today, really there are kind of four main themes that I want to just kind of raise. The first is really at least in cultural studies, there's a kind of emerging concept of the Sinophone that has actually enabled thinking about Cantonese in a very specific way. So I kind of want to throw that into the mix from the kind of academic side. Second, because of my own experience as a film studies scholar, the rise and fall, and perhaps rise and fall again, of Hong Kong cinema, for me, seems to be an important conversation when we talk about Cantonese culture globally. So I kind of touch on that a little bit. Since we have these very experienced and distinguished broadcasters with us, I also want to kind of ask some questions around Cantonese broadcast media, both in, I think, the Guangzhou and Hong Kong area, as well as across the Pacific right here on the West Coast. And I want to end with new media. And I think all of us, probably I saw many people on their phone, so I think all of us are kind of avid user of new media. And I know, Zoe probably probably has a lot of insights on this. So I want to kind of end with questions around how new media is facilitating or obstructing or creating kind of new ways to communicate in Cantonese. So that's sort of the overall structure. So just to say why Sinophone has been such an important concept for me, yesterday, I know from the linguistic point of view, Zoe has talked about why it actually doesn't make that much sense to talk about Chinese as a language. Now, in cultural studies, we also kind of question that, and we do it in a way that I think Sinophone is a concept that has enabled us to do it in a very interesting way, maybe a little bit more in a political way. So it came from Shi Shumei, whose book came out in 2007, and interesting to us in Canada, she kind of modeled it after Francophone. And that's a side discussion. Talking to Francophone scholars, I realized the politics behind Francophonie and Sinophone is actually quite different. But nonetheless, she was inspired by Francophone. If we can have Francophone, why can't we have Sinophone? And I think the conceptual imperative of Sinophone is really to denaturalize the idea that Chinese is an ethnic identity, is a nation, is a language, and they all align. So you speak Chinese, you are Chinese, you are from China, and there's no question about it. So Sinophone is really to remind us of especially the kind of history of conquest, colonial history, that builds itself or created itself on linguistic nationalism and the naturalization of Chinese, as all of those things actually make us forget how diverse the language really is. So in kind of her conceptualization, she asks us to remember kind of three histories that underpin the linguistic nationalism of thinking of Chinese as one language. So the first one is actually fairly provocative in that she thinks in the West we talk so much about oceanic colonialism. We are obsessed with European colonialism, everybody talking about it. But we don't think about what she called the continental colonialism. So she used that term to ask us to think about China's history from a lot of historians here. So all the way from the Manchu Empire and what it inherited to the kind of People's Republic in terms of a kind of colonizing force across the continent. And of course behind that continental colonialism, a kind of linguistic homogeneity, a kind of imposition of a linguistic order was very much part of it. The second really interesting point is to look at the settler colonialism. In Canada, we talked a lot about settler colonialism, but so she was pointing to the Chinese settler colonialism in society like Singapore and Taiwan. And in those two particular, when again, the linguistic project was clearly very militant, very forceful. Yesterday, some people were talking about the natural evolution of language, but we also mustn't forget the rather unnatural imposition of how language diversity is often shaped to maintain a sort of national identity. So she asks us to remember that. And the third, I think very relevant to us, is she asks us to remember Chinese migration globally. And I think in terms of languages, we as I see it, even in the Chinese Canadian scene in Vancouver, there's a linguistic divide. So people talk about writers writing in Chinese Canadian, writers writing in English, Chinese Canadian writers writing in Chinese. In Shi's conception, we shouldn't think of it that way, that even a Chinese Canadian writer writing in English, but maybe we're brought up listening to Chinese from the grandparents, watching TVB, all of those contribute to the Sinophone world. So, we should think of that together in diasporic community as sort of part of the Sinophone world. So she ends up, just a really nice quote, the word Chinese has been misused to equate language with nationality and ethnicity, and official monolingualism has disregarded and suppressed linguistic heterogeneity. Concept of Sinophone evinces multilinguality, not only in sound, but also in script. The Sinophone is not only of multiple sounds, but also of multiple orthographies. Furthermore, the concept of the Sinophone registers not only the multiplicity of Sinatic languages, but also how they undergo localization and creolization in relation to non-Sinatic languages in a given locality. So I find it a kind of very useful formation, and particularly when we look at media. So imagine a kind of Mandarin language historical soap opera playing in the Tibet region. There's a lot going on linguistically. So to only call that soap opera a Chinese production is missing out on all the linguistic interplay that happens in that encounter. So Shi wants us to say that might be a Sinophone. To call that production a Sinophone production then brings all of this back into play. Okay, so that's the kind of academic side of it. I, you know, being a film studies scholar, I have to mention Hong Kong cinema. And I think Hong Kong cinema in its heyday, you know, its glory days that we talked about yesterday as well, is really can be thought of as a global Cantonese media phenomenon. Although, ironically, I think at that time, Hong Kong cinema is not all that precious about itself being a Cantonese cinema. In fact, I think it was rather careless or quite happy for all the films to be dubbed into Mandarin in Mandarin-speaking market. So, you know, Stephen Chow, who I think of as the quintessential, you know, really Cantonese humor, had all his films dubbed into Mandarin, but, you know, he had one particular actor who dubbed him. And I don't think at that time Hong Kong cinema was so embroiled in its own identity as Hong Kong, you know, Hong Kong's aesthetic, urban identity, that it didn't really push its own cinema as Cantonese. It pushes it as Hong Kong, right? But nonetheless, even despite of that, because of its global popularity, Hong Kong cinema, I think, at that time, in its glory, made Cantonese a language of cinephilia. And I always use this example as an example. This is a kind of urban legend, but I think it's quite believable. It's probably true. This is probably one of the most iconic line of dialogue from Hong Kong cinema. This is from John Woo's film, A Better Tomorrow. So legend has it that when A Better Tomorrow was playing in Taiwan during the 80s, to a cinema of, you know, Mandarin and Taiwanese speakers, they have seen the film so much and love it so much that when this scene come along, when the Leslie Cheung character challenged, you know, the Dick Long character, you have to call me sir, because he's a police officer. And that iconic line from Dick Long, when he said that the whole entire theater of non-Cantonese speaker would repeat after him in Cantonese that line, and so for me, that, you know, kind of, it could be an urban legend, but what it says is that in that world, where, for Hong Kong cinema, Cantonese is the language of cinephilia. You haven't really embraced the film if you don't embrace it in Cantonese, right? So, of course, the situation now is much changed. Hong Kong cinema, there's all the discourse about death of Hong Kong cinema. From the heyday of 200-plus productions, now maybe 30 is a good number. And Liam was saying yesterday that it's interesting that all of that was being commented upon in Hong Kong cinema itself, which is true. So there's a lot of all these Hong Kong films that talk about its own death. Now, because it's dying, so suddenly there are lots of efforts to want to revive it. And in our context, one of the most interesting kind of path of revival is to remake it into a Cantonese cinema, that is a cinema for a Cantonese-speaking audience. So you can already track quite a few of these efforts. In 2010, they were kind of picked 20 of the most iconic Hong Kong films were reissued, rescreened, in Guangzhou, in the original Cantonese. And you can see in the media, they say it's Paul Tin Fong, right? It's, you know, they had always been only screened in Mandarin dub version. Now we're seeing them for the first time in Cantonese. And it's kind of being billed as, again, a cool thing, a cinephilic thing. Like, you've never really seen this film, now you have the opportunity. 2013, they said one of the only good things out of SIPA in this round of negotiation is that in mainland, there's a relaxation of Cantonese films being shown. So as long as they're Chinese subtitles, that you can that now screen films that are in Cantonese in the Guangzhou area. So again, that was seen as a nice move. Hong Kong cinema didn't care about it before in the 80s or 90s, but now it sees maybe that's one point to make us unique. Maybe then, you know, this would become a selling point. Don't have to make co-productions anymore, that this is like Cantonese language cinema. So I find it interesting whether or not, you know, the death of Hong Kong cinema may be giving way to a kind of the emergence of a Cantonese cinema. Now, the last Cantonese film I watched was an Asian-Canadian film. When I saw Julia Kwan's documentary on Vancouver's Chinatown last year, I heard a lot of Cantonese, and it felt very intimate to me. And I know, you know, Karen used a lot of Cantonese and other Sinophone languages in her film. Other filmmakers, I know Wayne Yong, who's a really interesting independent gay male filmmaker, and, you know, from the 90s on, he's made films that about Vancouver that pun on Cantonese, right? So I'm wondering, and this is one of the questions I want to throw out, you know, to Karen and also other panelists, whether or not we can see, because of the death of Hong Kong cinema and because of kind of, you see, efforts to rejuvenate or reconceptualize something as a Cantonese cinema, or at least a cinema for Cantonese audience, whether we it's possible to see the emergence of a transnational Cantonese filmscape. So the third section, which is interesting, is about broadcast media. And unlike the relaxation of rule about, you know, screening Cantonese film in Guangzhou, they're actually tightening regulation about other broadcasts such as TV. So interestingly, the kind of defend Cantonese movement that we saw was kind of most very vocal in 2010 in response to the attempt to regulate broadcast media. So when, you know, a regulation was passed that, you know, we're going to limit Cantonese language TV broadcasts, people went on the street, right, in Guangzhou, and that's very impressive. And since then, there have been lots of kind of interesting, you know, comics and art that came out that were kind of satirizing this move to gradually kind of attacking the use of Cantonese in mainstream media, particularly in the Guangdong region. And just a few days ago, I read about how there was a big brouhaha about McDonald's canceling the Cantonese takeout line. So a journalist actually tried to call for a takeout from McDonald's, wanted to order the Big Mac in Cantonese, and couldn't get the operator to understand. So he, you know, made quite a big deal out of it in the media. So that's sort of happening in the Guangdong region. And not surprisingly, it was supported and picked up in Hong Kong as well. But I think in Hong Kong that it has a slightly different cast than in Guangzhou. And I'm very curious to ask our panelists, you know, where they think the kind of convergence, but also maybe divergence between the kind of two, between Hong Kong and Guangzhou's sort of movement to protect Cantonese. I think in Hong Kong, you know, it's more politicized, and it's got, you know, it's linked to the concern around education, it's linked to the concern around preservation and heritage project as well. And of course, then Vancouver. I'm curious to hear about what is the situation in Vancouver. Only just canceled a bunch of their newscasts, including in Cantonese, and I'm curious to kind of know where is the Cantonese media in Vancouver going, and how does it relate to what's going on in Hong Kong and Guangzhou? Lastly, as maybe I should be tweeting someone about it, about social media, for me is very interesting. My 17-year-old niece, who grew up in Hong Kong, is now living in Britain, was staying with me over Christmas, and she loves sharing the drama, her drama, with her friends with me. So she was reading from her, you know, her text, and I was looking at, and she, you know, was reading out what they were saying, and it was all in Cantonese. So I thought, wow, you typed all those Cantonese? And then she showed me her text, and I realized they write in this very strange mixture that is like Romanized Cantonese in English with, you know, Chinese, easy to type Chinese words throw in, and they have voice text. And so they just, I suddenly realized that they are using Cantonese in new media in a whole other way, in a kind of digital way. And I'm curious, particularly to ask Zoe, what's happening there, and is it developing a different kind of writing that, you know, mixes romanization with using Chinese characters? And of course, there are other uses from social media that's really interesting. One is the kind of political usage. I'm sure we look at, you know, go to Jack's library in Toronto and look through the social media archive of the Umbrella Movement. I bet, I haven't counted it, I'll bet over 80% were in written Cantonese. When I was following Twitter at that time, people were writing in Cantonese, partly I think because it's more intimate, but the other part could be a kind of resistance or defiance feeling as well. So I just pull a very little example from Joshua Wong's Facebook, and if you look at the comments, they were almost over 80% were writing in Cantonese itself. So I know Eleanor was talking about there's a kind of vulgarization, you know, so in tabloid newspaper, which had been perhaps the most versatile form of written Cantonese in media, that maybe there's a kind of downward drift of kind of vulgar writing. But I wonder whether or not that's not, that balance is not being tipped on social media, where you just have everybody writing away in Cantonese. When I WhatsApp my uncle in Hong Kong, we would be WhatsApping in Cantonese now. And I have to say that was a change from after the Umbrella Movement. And because of, I think there's also other elements that facilitate that. So on the left is an advertisement for a new app that would help you text in Cantonese more easily. And I know there are also voice to text now with, in Cantonese. So the kind of technology, the advertisement, you know, also create the possibility for that to be used. So on the one hand, you have the kind of political defiance, I'm going to use it anyway. On the other hand, you also have, you know, technology, business that are making it easier, making it more appealing to use. So you know, that is also my question is, are we also developing or is writing in Cantonese? I take exception when people say Cantonese is an oral language. I always say no. It's a language with a writing that's been marginalized and, you know, made improper, not admitted into kind of proper writing, right? But I think there's something happening in the, on the writing side, which I find interesting. And the last example is also social media doesn't just exist online. It also exists as a way to facilitate face-to-face and real-life kind of interaction. And as I said, I met Liam in a meetup group. And as you can see, they have like they actually have over 500 members, and they do activities like, you know, Yao Sang Wun Sui in Stanley Park. There were like, you know, just meetup for self-improvement discussion. And none of that would be possible without social media, because, you know, meetup really is facilitated through the app, through people posting where to meet, you know. So I think we also, when we look at social media, it's not just looking at the online world. It's also looking at how it can be used to facilitate a kind of real life, you know, kind of a context that would otherwise not be possible. So before I turn, I will end on what may be a very old media. And I've been using the images from these picture cards, and I have to say I came across these picture cards about 3-4 years ago when I was in Amsterdam. I was hanging out with 3 or 4 diasporic, you know, Cantonese speakers, and one of them bought this back from Hong Kong, and we like had the greatest time. We learned so many words. It's actually done by a high school teacher who kind of just made this card giving the definition of all of the most trendy Cantonese words used now. And of course, my favorite is the one for favorite, which really show you what a creative, flexible, elastic, and also very translinguistic way that Cantonese can often develop. And also, if you notice, the example is also in written Cantonese. So in these picture cards too, I really take Shi's point that we're not only talking about you know, oral language, we are also talking about things that are happening in writing. So, that's like where I'm going next, is to maybe ask the panelists to just give some initial thoughts on some of the questions raised, or maybe concerns that I didn't put on the table that you'd like to put on the table. So maybe I will, maybe should we go down the table? If Zoe doesn't mind.
I have some stuff to show.
Sure, sure.
Do
you need this one? Right, maybe, should we start with Liam?
Yeah.
Then I'll let you give Zoe some time to,
Are you sure? Okay. Well then, I guess I'll take up your comments about the death of Hong Kong cinema. The thing I'd like to say about that is what's interesting from my perspective is it seems like Hong Kong cinema has died several times. I don't know if you sort of look back a little ways into history, the early 20th century, you had silent films in Cantonese that are pre-war, right, films that are now mostly lost. I don't think we have originals of any of those anymore. So that's sort of a golden age that passed. During the war, there was a hiatus. During the Japanese occupation, they tried to make one film, and that fell through. After the war, we've talked before about how there was this resurgence of you could call it bilingual cinema, not bilingual films, but films that were either in Mandarin or in Cantonese, with Mandarin dominating by the mid-70s. That's kind of a golden age. I don't think that's the golden age that we're talking about here today. But when I think back to the golden age of Hong Kong cinema, I mean, you've got, Wong Tin Lam and things like this. It's a great film, Nam Bak Wo, 1961, that, of course, Wong Tin Lam is Wong Jing's father. So this film is actually half in Cantonese and half in Mandarin. And it's about the interaction between people speaking these two languages. So there was a whole period of classic films, what you might call, Yu Cheng Bin, things like that. And then you get to the mid-70s, and Mandarin films have completely dominated because television was in Cantonese, and film was in Mandarin, and that's just the way it was. And everyone was okay with that. And 1972, there were no Cantonese films made at all. I don't know if you can believe that in Hong Kong. Nobody made any Cantonese films that year. 1973, there was one film made in Hong Kong. It was Tsatsabiga Fong Hak. I don't know if you remember this film. It was one film, but it sort of, I guess, Potin Fong is the appropriate word for it, because it was kind of proved that you could make a film in Cantonese that would be popular and that would bring people out. It was the highest grossing film that year. We will think of, 1973, 74, they might think the highest grossing film was Mang Long Kok Gong, Return of the Dragon. It wasn't, it was this sort of very Hong Kong kind of film that just, that really reflected everyday Hong Kong life. And then by the end of the 70s, beginning of the 80s, there were no more Mandarin films. So then you have what we're referring to as the golden age in this kind of a symposium. I think we're talking about the period between the 80s and the early 90s. That's what people think back to. And possibly the 90s with Mo Lei Tao and things like that. So I just think that's so many, ups and downs and dying and coming back to life. It seems par for the course that Hong Kong cinema would be dying. It's like a phoenix that's got to die and come back to life. I also think it ties in with what Eleanor was saying earlier about vulgarization, which is an interesting comment. And I wonder what you think about Zhou Xingqi and, all this. Like, these films are the epitome of what, at the time, people thought of as vulgarization. And now people look back and they say, wow, this was the golden age. This was the best, the epitome of Cantonese culture. So it's just interesting to kind of look back with a historical gaze and kind of get some perspective so we don't all panic.
Yeah, I mean, just one comment is, I think the way we describe Hong Kong cinema right now is not only a Hong Kong-centric perspective, it's also a maybe my generation centric, like people, the generation that kind of came of age in when Hong Kong identity started to gel, like in the 70s. And I think it did, you're right, it did kind of, and it's when Hong Kong cinema became kind of global and international. And it is, there's a willful forgetting of something before that may be kind of linguistically diverse. It might be like Cantonese, it might not be so Hong Kong, but very Cantonese. So again, I think since that, the era that everybody's lamenting about is over, rather than thinking about getting back to it, I think it's interesting to think about something new. And we often, the something new can be crafted by something old, right? So something more, maybe a linguistically pluralistic or diverse Sinophone cinema that is both Hong Kong and, migrant, could be something quite interesting and progressive.
Right, and also useful to point out that the death of Hong Kong cinema, when we talk about the mid-90s, the Asian financial crisis and all that, that was also the birth of the Hong Kong New Wave. I mean, He Yuan Hua and all the filmmakers, Lo Tso Yu, all these people. So that should kind of indicate that this is, very cyclical, and in the ashes of the so-called decline, we always have very creative resurgences.
So maybe we'll move on to Gabriel for some thoughts.
Well, I think Liam is quite right. Hong Kong cinema has died quite a few times. But every time when we thought that it's over, then we got suddenly a great movie came out. And then all of a sudden, of course, you have other producer, other companies follow the same thing. Of course, the recent trend, the last trend probably is the Ip Man. And how many Ip Man movies that we have? Well, I guess even Wong Jing might have one Ip Man movie, but we also have Wong Kar Wai's Ip Man movie as well. So when will be the next hit? That's, I think it's a million-dollar question. But I think it's very important to know that how the Hong Kong entertainment industry has not only promoted the Cantonese language, but also the identity and the culture. Well, Karen is a fourth generation, Chinese-Canadian. I think a lot of, say, from my encounter here, a lot of the local-born Chinese people at my age or even older than me, they actually speak very little Chinese language or Cantonese language, not to mention read or write. There are a lot of different factors, say the hostile racism society at that time, the kind of identity rejection is one thing. But if you take a look at the more younger generation, like my kids, my daughter is 21 years of age, even though she was not happy when we get her to the Chinese school at young age. But still, I think she eventually enjoy learning a language, speaking a language, as well as trying to write sometimes, like Popo San, Fai Log, these kind of thing. But I think the one thing that makes a huge difference, other than the social environments that, well, in the past, well, when you speak Cantonese, maybe 50 years ago, speak Cantonese in a community center or in a workplace, well, people might stare at you or even you may got some negative feedback. But nowadays, it's no longer the case. But more important, it's the mainstream culture from Hong Kong. Well, we live in the same house, we live with our in-laws, though they watch Chinese television, TVB television, and they follow the same TV series. And sometimes they listen to songs. I think that makes a huge difference. And not only that, while by watching those television series, they have to learn the language, follow the storyline, but at the same time, they also gain the identity and confidence and the interest to practice, to use the language. I think this is very important. My own experience is I remember the first time I visited New York was about 20 years ago. I was quite shocked when I visited Chinatown because to me, it was a live museum because I saw people living in different era. I saw people, how they dress, how they speak, how they shop, or even how they entertain. There are people sitting next to me in a Chinese restaurant still talking about going to those dancing nightclub, Moutang, and they are wearing bell-bottom jeans, suit, those kind of thing. So it was quite a shock to me because, well, I was fresh from Hong Kong. I never seen such thing in Hong Kong anymore, even though I grew up in the same society. But what I could find explanation is because, well, when a lot of immigrants left Hong Kong or China, they actually stuck or freeze into that era. So, well, the kind of language, how they dress, it's pretty much the same. And it actually basically preserved there. But the reason nowadays is different is because there's a media as a very important element. Because, well, when they in those days when they moved to America and Canada, well, they don't have the Chinese television. They have very little chance to actually watch the Hong Kong television, don't see the latest trend, the kind of how people speak. Even nowadays, if you watch some of the Hong Kong television, like earlier, there was a Sing Lui or Jok Jin. I was shocked. The kind of language that people speak, normal people speak in those so-called documentary, it's very different than us. The kind of television we watch on TV nowadays is not the real language people on the street in Hong Kong speaking. So that's the experience, but my explanation is actually this is the media who actually influence how people not only dress, think, shop, the language, those kind of things. So this is how important language, the media to us. And the example, it's Guangzhou. I remember the first time I went to Guangzhou, how the people speak is different. It's very much like people reading from a book. But of course nowadays, well, if you listen to, you travel to Guangzhou or you listen to the radio station there, actually sometimes you cannot distinguish whether this is a Hong Kong or a Guangzhou program, if that is not a current affairs or political show.
Gabriel opened many really interesting points, and Karen, would you care to have some insight?
Maybe I'll just start with a little bit of my background. As Helen was saying, my family came here in like the 1800s, late 1800s. And I remember my mother would tell me that her father her father who was born here used to be called Saiwashi, because Saiwash was a Chinook jargon word that people here used that were comprised of different dialects of First Nations, English, French, German, so on and so forth. And so they would call the Canadian-born Chinese Saiwashi, because Saiwash was the word that meant sauvage. It came from the French. And that's what they called Indian people. So it was a derogatory term that they would use for Canadian-born Chinese in the early 1900s. And after that, my mother would get called Chok Sing, because she didn't have any language, she didn't have any culture. And of course, by that time, you know, with the racism and everything that was going on at that time, people didn't really have any ability to acquire anything new. And as Gabriel said, there was no media at that time. And by the time it was my generation, fourth generation, we were called CBCs. So then it turned from Chinook jargon to the Toisan to, you know, like an English version of another generation of sort of, you know, hollow, culturally hollow Canadian-born Chinese. And it's interesting in my daughter's generation, she's in high school, she's 14. She goes to an Eastman school, and she keeps saying to me, why don't you teach me Cantonese? And I said, well, I can't teach you Cantonese, because actually I acquired Mandarin because I thought it would be more, you know, useful, and I don't really know Cantonese. And she said, well, everybody at school speaks another language. So you have the Namers, the Vietnamese kids that can speak their Vietnamese. We've got the Swagapinos, the Filipino kids that are all speaking their language. You know, everybody's got a language that they can speak as a second language. So I think it's really cynical in a certain sense that in my generation, I probably would have rejected this idea of acquiring language and culture. And in her generation, she really feels the peer pressure, because it's not only just the media, it's the demographics, that in Vancouver, it's a very Asian city. And the second generation kids that are here now, the FOBs, they all speak, and you know, these are terms that the kids are using, and I'm not saying that in a derogatory sense. They say that towards each other. They're all able to use Mandarin and Cantonese and, you know, the Vietnamese and so on and so forth. So there's a certain kind of a pride. Now, so we've sort of almost gone full circle, that there's a kind of a Canto pride, and she, on her father's side, her grandfather is Hakka. She doesn't know what Hakka is, but now she's starting to realize that there is actually another dialect, or there's another language which she has and should have some access to. So maybe after many generations, and then your daughter is happy that she has the ability to communicate in those languages, and you have the ability to give that to her. But in my generation, I can't give that to her, because my mother doesn't really speak Cantonese. She speaks a very old form of Toisanwa that she learned here from her father, who learned it from his parents, because he was born here. So everything, all the language that they use, has been stuck in time. But I think that it was also interesting for me in my media practice, because I'm so inspired by so many of the people, you know, everybody on the panel, and Henry Yu, and this idea of history, you know, how can we reflect the history here? And for me, linguistic authenticity is really important. So when I was working with Henry on the 100-year anniversary of the anti-Asian riots, we voiced that installation using Unping and Toisan and, you know, all the dialects that were used at the time. And the generations before me would say, well, you know, Toisan is getting displaced by Cantonese because all the Hong Kong immigrants came, you know, in the 60s. Or the sort of family reunification in 49, there was also a new generation of young people who spoke Cantonese that were educated and were joining their families. And then the Hong Kong wave, and then the wave in the 80s. And as you can see in Chinatown and everywhere else, there was a real shift to go from Toisan to Cantonese and now to Mandarin. And so that displacement is actually, it just seems to go with the wave of immigration. And I think for my work, and like now I'm writing a script that uses Chinook jargon and Toisanwa and English and French and, you know, so on and so forth. There's this adaptation that lexicon, words will come into your lexicon because of your environment. And I find it's just really fascinating when you talk about how they use pinyin for the Cantonese, and, you know, all the generations, subsequent generations, are going to continue to sort of meld and create sort of a new culture, so to speak. And I think the death of the language is actually what really gets people moving in doing something like Hong Kong cinema and so on.
That is so interesting, and I just have one comment, because I think Shi's idea of the Sinophone wants to accommodate or include what Karen's talking about. And I had one grad student who asked me such a smart question. She said, okay, if Sinophone is about any use of Sinophone languages, when do you stop remembering a language? And that was, for me, very resonant, because you talked about your generation not speaking the language, but it's in your memory, it's been heard, and can we actually really say that there's no Sinophoneness in it? And I know Roy Mickey, who's a Japanese-Canadian poet, he's often written about, he said he grew up not knowing Japanese, but because he heard it so much that in his poetry, in his poetics, that sound that he can't articulate but remember is very much in his poetics, right? So that really makes me feel like, you know, if we think about Sinophone, it's not even just about, even if you had stopped talking the language, that experience or that history of migration is probably in you, your expression. And so I think it's very provocative if Sinophone actually includes that, rather than to separate this is English, you know, Anglo-Asian-Canadian production, and that's Chinese-Asian-Canadian production. To see all of those things together as Sinophone production is quite interesting. Yeah. But so we'll move on to Ken for your insights.
Thank you very much. Well, thank you for having me and having us to discuss this. We talk about movies, and if you talk about Cantonese movie, I remember the black and white M'Chofan. Okay, those days in the 50s and 60s, movies were used as a teaching tool, talking about moral. But now, after Zhao Xingqi, become entertainment, so it's changing. So if you look at TV, now they have just recent Mo Mei Liang, 讲的毛泽天 from the Make in China. So very popular now, but it's translated back into Cantonese. And interestingly, I heard this morning the radio, the ending song, the theme song is in Cantonese. So it's from a Chinese production still to fit in the market. And there's an other one I watch here, very popular, is Three Countries, Sam Go. Okay, so now, but if you look at the influence from China on the movie, they are still making popular ones still in the old days, old Wuzhong, old fashioned, historical. The modern still reflect the society, still come from the Hong Kong. Looking at the most recent web, they couldn't get a license, the Hong Kong TV, they have to go on the web for broadcasting. Those are the still in Cantonese, talking about modern as well, so reflect the politics as well. So very interesting. But I want to move from movie to radio, to media. So I do daily show in Cantonese. So if you look at nowadays Cantonese use, if you look at the population outside China, outside Hong Kong, speak Cantonese and Macau. As a matter of fact, big cities with the Taishan in the older time, several generations of immigrant from the 90s, from the 70s, 60s, 70s, there's one wave of Hong Kong immigrant come to North America. Like David Lam, our governor, lieutenant governor, that's actually one wave from Hong Kong because of a riot. And then in the 90s, because of 97 or 1989, Tiananmen issue, incident, people came. Now, I think those people will stay in speaking Cantonese. It is a tool to communicate. Maybe 10 years ago, 8 years ago, when we talk about radio, we concern about the audience. Will the audience of the radio shrink? But as a matter of fact, if you compare today, the radio audience compared to TV, to press, radio actually increased. The reason is in the technology, people use iPhone, there's an app you can listen. Going from driving a car, you can listen in a car, you can drive at the same time, you cannot read newspaper. So radio audience, especially we reflect from the marketing department, we know we have more audience. So that's interesting part. But if you look at the core products in the radio, news definitely is a very important one. Entertainment definitely important. Songs, very important as well. But if you notice, the prime time, my program with Travina Lee, she's the news director, and Dr. K.K. Wang, three of us, from 8:30 to 9:30, that is a prime time, the drive time. So we have the majority of Cantonese audience from the market, reflect from our sales department. But afternoon, 3 o'clock, Anita Lee, which is ET Today, Entertainment Today kind of style, a lot of audience too. She mixed news with entertainment. So the audience wants something softer, you know, that is a lot of audience too. So if you look at Cantonese, there's still a lot of people using Cantonese. And the comparing to others, we're talking about press, but if you look at press and TV, people moving on the social media, on the internet. So even radio, all those, we put our news, our production with clips. So you see all are mixing now. So the market is not just Vancouver, but Toronto or some other area. So when I go outside Vancouver, I use apps to listen radio. I listen to Hong Kong radio as well. But if you're thinking about, I move a little bit wider, is when we acquire news, we don't just rely on newspaper. We read the 8 newspaper every day. But when we want to understand Hong Kong's newspaper, news, I would say, we look at the current one. Right away, maybe evening time in Hong Kong, 12 o'clock, 11 o'clock. But Hong Kong is influenced by different background now. Some, there are fake news. There are partially truth news. So we have to look at different source to verify the news. And so when we produce Cantonese news, but we have to look into different source. They may not be Cantonese, but that is the, when we look at the media, we look at the news, the information, I think that is a trend of the market now.
Really interesting, and it actually doesn't make sense anymore to talk about traditional media and new media, right? Because in a way, traditional media is thoroughly embedded in new media as well, right? Mm-hmm. Yeah. So Zoe, would you like to?
Yeah, sure.
Share your insights.
So there are two things that I want to say. The first one is about the response to the quote about Sinophone. So there's this tie between ethnicity, language, and nationality. And the second thing that I want to talk about is written Cantonese. Mm-hmm. So for the first point, we all know that we cannot draw an equal sign between language, ethnicity, and nationality. You can be ethnic Chinese, you live in Montreal, and you speak French. That's So we all know that we cannot draw this line. But when it comes to Cantonese identity, we kind of had this assumption that if you speak Cantonese, you're ethnic Chinese. Mm-hmm. So who could be the people who are not ethnic Chinese, but they speak Cantonese? There are actually people like that in Hong Kong, and they're South Asians, and they have lived in Hong Kong for many number of years. And these are people that are forgotten when we talk about Cantonese worlds, but because of the new media, these people become visible. So one example is Vivek Mabubani. So he is a stand-up comedian, and this video was from 2007, and it went viral. And he speaks fluent Cantonese because he was born and raised in Hong Kong. So I'm sure all Chinese Canadians would think that if someone asks you the question, oh, your English is so good, where did you learn your English? You will feel that this is a stupid question, right? But we ask the exact same question to South Asian, ethnic South Asians like that in Hong Kong. And if we watch part of the stand-up comedy, we'll find that a lot of the jokes are about living in Hong Kong as a South Asian, ethnic South Asian. So we can watch part of that. And don't be shocked.
Chinese，喺香港做一個好似我咁嘅外國人咧，其實係好慘嘅，知唔知？你知啊？你會知啊？Anyway，你諗下，可能啲人會同我講話：，喂，你有鬼好著數喎，我唔係白人嚟㗎，我可以周圍同人講話，教你講英文啦咁樣。 咁啲人就會同我講話，唔係喎，你有黑人著數，喂，hip hop咁樣入樽，優咁樣，得㗎。我係一個啡色皮膚嘅叉仔，一個印度人，淨係可以當毛同埋一陣咖喱味嘅人，得㗎。咁。 我話俾你知啊，喺香港做一個識講中文嘅外國人係仲慘，真係根本會令人失望㗎。你諗下，你見到一個外國人行過嚟，哇，好學下英文講下幾個英文，教佢幾個中文幾威啊？見到我就唔得㗎啦，係咪？我有一日喺街市嗰度買嘢，咁我諗住買啲生果啦，見到個生果佬行過去，佢見到我好開心 ，Hey 朋友，各位朋友，好靚啊，好～ 三個橙，十蚊四個，你講自己睇啦。咁我見到佢咁失望，我話：唉，好啦，要三個橙啊，崩油。佢話：我哋崩油，崩油，好啦，你四個你啦。我咪真㗎咧。咁好多時啲人就會問我：，你點解會識講中文嘅？你邊個學㗎？咁樣。咁我以前就冇讀嗰啲國際學校嘅，因為我真係太窮。 你估得啱，我老豆係真係做嗰啲銀行看家嘅，真㗎！我阿媽就日日真係煮咖喱雞俾我食，好中意曬。OK，你諗下，我點會有錢啊？係咪？咁我就去讀嗰啲政府學校，但係政府學校咧教嗰啲中文咧係唔齊㗎，好多嘢唔會教你啊，俗語啊嗰啲咁嘅嘢唔識㗎嘛。咁我以前小學嗰陣時，10歲喺個球場，俾啲黑社會鬥，咁你行過嚟。
So this is super cool, right? I may post the link on the website later so you can watch the full clip. But if we look at the comments, it's even more funny because he already stated that he was born and raised in Hong Kong, but people still left comments like, where did you learn your Chinese? Your Chinese is so good. Yeah. So we see these kind of comments. So it seems that a lot of people still cannot accept the fact that a non-ethnic Chinese person can speak native Cantonese.
So I think this is an interesting phenomenon because yesterday in the keynote speech I mentioned migration from Cantonese-speaking regions to other parts of the world, but I didn't mention the other direction of migration, mm-hmm. which is elsewhere in the world to Cantonese-speaking regions, mm-hmm. like India to Hong Kong, or New Zealand to Hong Kong, Australia to Hong Kong. But these people exist, and they should be represented somehow in the discourse about Cantonese words. And I think the media really play an important role in giving these people a voice. And there is another clip about a Caucasian guy called Carlos. He lived in Abbotsford in BC, and he made a lot of videos on YouTube teaching people how to use Cantonese slangs, and it went viral in Hong Kong. And his wife has Cantonese background, and it's funny, he lived in Canada, but he became really popular in Hong Kong. And this is an interview on Omni News.
隨著短片分享網站YouTube越來越流行，唔少人都鍾意拍返條短片然後放上網公司同號。Melbourne就有個男仔拍咗好多條教人廣東話嘅短片放上YouTube度，究竟有啲咩咁特別呢？一齊嚟睇下。新年快樂，恭喜發財，身體健康。明明係一個用標準廣東話拜年嘅人，點解會一個西人嚟嘅呢？ Carlos 之前喺香港住咗兩年，覺得既然住落咗，就應該學校廣東話，仲幫自己改咗個中文名叫做杜卓林，希望識朋友都可以方便啲。咁後嚟佢覺得廣東話越學越得意。我覺得
Chinese 係一個成日 evolve 緊嘅 language，evolving language， 成日都有啲新嘅 words 會出嚟啊，會有人講 ，like and it's always fun to learn those new words。
翻到嚟温哥華 ，Carlos 對廣東話嘅興趣並冇減少到。佢而家每個禮拜都會拍一條短片，放喺 YouTube 同網友分享。咁題材全部都係環繞香港近年流行嘅潮語，例如要形容一啲橫蠻無理嘅女仔，就可以用呢一個形容詞。
公主病。話人哋影相嗰陣個樣好作狀，就可以話佢哋挫陽。Today I reached 10,000 subscribers.
Carlos
上載嘅短片受到大批網民歡迎，幾條片加埋有成百幾萬人睇過，連香港嘅雜誌都要揾佢做訪問，網友提供嘅意見都非常正面。其實成日都話你中文咁犀利啊，好標準啦、啊，或者好流利咁啊。有陣時其實都會有啲人講，哇，其實你講咗呢個字講錯咁啊，或者你有啲錯音啊啲，咁我都知其實我啲中文唔係 perfect 嘅。
So due to time constraint, I will not show the full clip, but you can Google Carlos Stowe and you'll find his video clips. So the point here is that how can we give a voice to non-ethnic Chinese when we talk about Cantonese words? And the second thing that I want to mention is written Cantonese. So a lot of people would think that written Cantonese is improper or is not decent written language, it's colloquial. So actually more than 10 years ago, Professor Robert Bauer in Hong Kong already proposed a set of characters for written Cantonese, but not many people accepted it because we still have this idea that written Cantonese is not proper. But if we think about standard Chinese that we use today, in the first few decades of the 20th century is considered not good written Chinese because back then people considered classical Chinese scholarly. But then after a series of movements, the vernacular style was adopted as standard Chinese, and then now we use it in announcements and newspapers and so on. So if we think about the bigger picture, actually why can't we write Cantonese? So if we look at this Facebook group called Hong Kong Language Studies, it's a group of young people who are really concerned about the future of Cantonese, and recently they organized a writing competition, Guangdonghua Jingmen Beichai. So they encourage people to write prose in Cantonese with Cantonese words like ge, go, and di, and so on. And we can look at one of the awardees' masterpiece. So like this one. It's called 我同爸爸煲冬瓜. So 我係一個音誒，我今日 so we see words like 係 and 嘅 and other words that consider dialect words. Yeah. So I think in the mainstream education, this is considered bad. If we write anything like that in the language class, Chinese language class, the teacher would give us a big props. But linguistically, there is really no right or wrong about that. As long as it reflects how speakers use the language, then yeah, it can be used linguistically. So I think these media, these groups online, can really push us to rethink about what is proper, what can be written and what cannot be written.
Mm-hmm. We have that. All the insights are really interesting, and I, you know, even I myself have like tens of, twenties of questions. But because we have about 30 minutes left, so I really want to open all the topics up for Q&A from the audience. And also, you know, anybody from the panel at any time, you want to comment, recap on anything, please feel free to take the floor.
Yeah, so, yeah absolutely. Response yes. to Zoe. I want to quickly respond to Zoe. The, when, as a matter of fact, last year I searched on the Wikipedia. There's Chinese, there's English, and many languages. But there's one called Yu Cantonese, and it is written like this way. But I think this phenomenon is really happened recently because Hong Kong or Guangzhou feel the pressure of some force is trying to eliminate the Cantonese. That is a counter force of doing it. So, and if you look at it, it become, I think, I feel people feel like, especially Hong Kong and Guangzhou and the Guangdong area, feeling the pressure. I think this is a development of the, in China to the southern part of China and Hong Kong. So it is an interesting discussion. We can, you know, but you lay out a very wide area we can talk about today. So I let the audience to drive different questions.
Yeah. One anecdote that supports Zui's point, back in the 1990s, late 90s, I studied with a Cantonese opera scholar, Chen Zouyan, at the Chinese University of Hong Kong. And at that point, he has a very good connection with Basusin. And one day he visited her at her home, and at some point he said, "Well, Xin Zhe, Chen, you cook egg." And then Basusin said to him, "Gam ya lam chang la, o gu Mabel tong li chang la." And Mabel was her Filipino maid. So, and so I would be very, very curious to go to the Yambak collection at the Chinese University of Hong Kong, the music department, and see if any presence of that Mabel exists somewhere. And so that would kind of complicate the discourse a little bit. You know, that would make a very, very interesting kind of, you know, undergraduate thesis or even MA thesis. And just to have that kind of voice, that presence in that discourse, and I find it quite complex.
Just to add a quick point, John Ernie and Lisa Low, is Lisa Ling from Ling, John Ernie from Baptist University and Lisa Ling from Lingnan University, they did a book on South Asian minorities in Hong Kong, and they also did a creative project with South Asian minority kids who make film videos about bullying, and a majority of those videos are in Cantonese. So I think it is definitely happening with a lot more attention paid. And they also compile a filmography of Hong Kong films that feature South Asian minorities, and most of the actors like were fluent in Cantonese. So I think there is a kind of emerging awareness definitely of that issue, and I think it helps us, yeah, like you said, disentangle Cantonese from being the language and ethnicity that, and also a kind of Hong Kong centricness to it, which I also find can be problematic. So, you know, Cantonese actually for me a much wider, you know, transnational, transcultural kind of phenomenon. Hong Kong is important, but I think when we talk Cantonese, it's also something different. It's not reducible to just Hong Kong. Right? The mic is going around, I think.
I just would like to talk about language and ethnicity. I just would like to give an example. I have a girlfriend of Japanese background. She came here, she learned English and French. She married someone of Italian background. He was born and raised up here. So at home, they just talk to each other in English and French. And then they adopted a girl from China. And the girl arrived here when she was 1 year old. And although she was brought up in a French and English home here in Canada, every time when they went out, my girlfriend told me that wherever she hears Cantonese, she would turn, she would pay attention, although she's just 1 year old. So I think that shows something about how strong Cantonese is as a Kongsai语言. In an environment, especially in a multicultural environment like Vancouver. So I think, you know, that's something that at another dimension when we are considering Cantonese as a language and its link to ethnicity, especially like in Canada, in Vancouver, something like that. That's my personal experience. And also I got many, many friends who were in multicultural marriages. Actually, their children, they are facing exactly the same thing. Thank you.
Yeah, I think if I can add, I believe Cantonese is also the oldest language or dialect in China. That is what I learned when I was in Beijing talking to some of the Mandarin teachers. They said, oh, you speak the oldest language. I said, what? And then we said, well, Cantonese is actually the oldest, especially when you take a look at those historical, those poems, those kind of writing. Using Cantonese to pronounce it actually sounds way better than the Mandarin. That is what I was told. But at the same time, I think I wonder whether we pay too much attention in terms of minority, say we have Filipino singing Cantonese opera, but to me, well, we have a lot of Chinese people, we have a lot of other races, non-Italian people singing Italian opera. So does it mean that, well, we are worrying that the Cantonese is going to die, we are extinguishing, that's why we try to figure out a lot of different elements or phenomenons to actually justify that Cantonese is still going to survive? I agree a little bit with, I'd like to add a little bit on what Ken said. Although in recent years, we have a lot of, the Chinese immigrants actually basically from mainland China nowadays. But as a person who actually do a lot of door knockings, not only for my campaign, but also for other politicians, at first I was a little shocked that actually a lot of the people, especially living in Vancouver, they are actually Cantonese speaking. And the reason is not only that those are Hong Kong immigrants, because a lot of immigrants from southern China, they speak Cantonese. And at least I can tell in East Vancouver, the Cantonese speaking people is way, way more than the Mandarin-speaking people. In Richmond, I don't know, but I think there is a perception that we have a lot of Mandarin people around, but as I said, well, Cantonese-speaking people, I think at this point, probably still outnumber the Mandarin people in our society right now.
I'm just gonna continue on with what Gabriel was saying. I think in East Vancouver, in my neighborhood, there's the same set of Toisan ladies that walk around the park and then walk up the block, and they're very loud, and they're always speaking in Toisanwa at like 7:30 in the morning. So my kids are always waking up to the sound of Toisanwa and, you know, these ladies and the old men and the people that are in the park talking in that language and that dialect. And I think that because, you know, as Gabriel was saying, there's a whole generation and the demographics of the people in Vancouver that are predominantly Cantonese are usually out on the street in East Vancouver. I don't actually hear a lot of Mandarin being spoken on the street in the same way. And I think that kind of idea that you can I think in some ways Cantonese does have to move on, and but the film that I'm working on is really about a young girl who's going to get her feet bound in Barkerville in the late 1800s, and her parents somehow they want to continue on with this tradition, this cultural tradition, and in the end, of course, she finds her own way to move away from getting her feet bound, and it's called Elke Andante, and it's a Chinook jargon word for the future long ago, because the future a long time ago was to prepare yourself for the world that was coming, and the new world that she was living in. And I think that this movement away from Cantonese, or what China is doing around unifying the language and suppressing Cantonese, is this idea that, you know, you're going to be preparing for China to be unified linguistically, and that dialect, which is not the official language, is not going to be as useful anymore, and you're in some sense preparing for it. But it doesn't mean that it's going to die naturally. It will die probably institutionally.
The microphone, anyway.
I just want to give some data. Not long ago, I read some article about globally, there are over 120 million people speak Cantonese. Globally, and majority, of course, in Guangdong province of China. But around the world, Cantonese is the majority language among Chinese, and also some overseas Chinese. And on top of that, about the written Cantonese, in the old day, in the past, we all heard about Cantonese cannot be written in character. But not long ago, I mean talking about last month, I just tried to go through my cell phone to get that article out. I couldn't. There are so many ancient poems actually write on Cantonese. So I don't know why people keep saying Cantonese cannot be written. There are so many ancient poems talking about in Tang Dynasty. They're all written in Cantonese. But unfortunately, I couldn't get it out from my cell phone. I got that article. There are so many examples. So I think we have to look into Cantonese in another direction now. Try to find more. Actually, I believe many people, many scholars, they are doing a lot of study and research on the so-called movement of Cantonese. So I believe on the website we could find more and more in the near future. Thank you.
Sometimes we talk as if there is only one language that we can use, and this is sometimes because of the political situation. So when Karen talked about institutionally, Cantonese may go just like the way Taishan has to give way to Cantonese. So now Cantonese has to give way to Mandarin, at least in Chinatowns around the world. That seems to be that trend right now. It is not just the language that I think a lot of people are concerned. Whether a language is able to continue is all the values as well as the culture that goes with it. I remember 30 years ago, I was asked my opinion. Do you think Chinese Cantonese is going to die because now there is this urge to prepare yourself to learn Mandarin? This is 30 years ago. And at that point, I was more confident. I said, as long as we continue to produce all these great songs in Cantonese, as long as there are Cantonese good movies, coming out from Hong Kong or elsewhere, then Cantonese will not die. But looking at what is going on, if you just look at our topic this morning on Cantonese opera, right, it's not just having Cantonese opera being sung by people today. There's this whole package when your musician no longer play because they cannot sustain their livelihood just because there are not enough people performing Cantonese opera. That art slowly died as she eroded. And when the school system did not really legitimize Cantonese opera, because I tried to keep it a secret that I can sing Cantonese opera when I was in the Anglo schools that I was studying in, because people laughed at you. That's peer pressure. You will sing, you know, the Beatles, but not Cantonese opera. Right? But today, politically, after 1997, immediately in the Hong Kong school system, Cantonese opera was actually taught. It's in the syllabus. And this is why we begin to see younger people getting engaged, getting excited, feeling proud. And some of these kids are doing very well. The music festival, the famous music festival in the school system in Hong Kong, they actually have now Cantonese opera included. So my point is, sometimes we just have to rethink. There may be a language that's predominant, but we have also to think that, why is it that we think we can only use one predominant language? Right? I wish that there are enough people who are speaking Taiwanese today so that we don't lose everything else that's embedded in that language. Right? I regretted not having that chance to learn my father's language. I'm the oldest in the family, and when I was born, being the first one, my father was so confident. This is in Hong Kong. He told my mother, all my children will be speaking my language as well. Well, unfortunately, we just don't. So I regretted that. And if we look at all the different languages that are here and how much we have already lost, well, there's a big need that today, if we feel that a certain language, whether it's a First Nations language or Cantonese that we're talking about today, there's a responsibility that we do not just let it slip away. I don't want to see it being replaced. I mean, these things sometimes can exist together, even though there may be one more predominant than the other.
So both Ken and Zoe have a response, and I remember there's a question back there too.
Yeah.
Let's start with Ken.
There are several perspectives to look at the Cantonese. Will it be institutionally replaced? If you look at the, I have some friends now, probably in his 50 and 40, still speak fluently Shanghaiese. The reason is when people from Shanghai to Hong Kong, they speak the dialects. Language is, I would say, is really inclusive and could be coexist. 那个多也咪海产咯，挨下客家言啊。 So if you speak those, you carry on. But in the situation in politically in China is different. If you look at the two decades when Deng Xiaoping start open up China politically, changing from communism to open market. The leaders have a very main objective is to keep China one country. The first one is really how to make Taiwan into part of China. Same thing after 97, Hong Kong and Macau be part of China. And there would be no leader would allow Taiwan or Hong Kong to be sort of independent. So language is definitely a very important tool. If you look at the politically change, especially the southern China, Guangzhou, have a very good, strong relationship with Hong Kong from 60s, 70s, even though the phenomenon happened in China, and Guangzhou, Guangdong area still have good support from Hong Kong. And the Hong Kong TV can be watched in Guangzhou,
they have different culture than the other location of China. So when Deng Xiaoping wanted to open up the market, he picked Shenzhen. So because he knows there will be industrial influence from Hong Kong. So if you look at those. If you talk to Shanghainese, they also have a strong, big pressure from central government want to influence the politics in Shanghai as well as a big city. So now what happened is they to influence Guangdong area, they have to change the culture. Language for the younger generation is one of the tools. But recently, well, actually, my son married a Korean descent, Canadian, very young, both young couple. So we have a good news. September, there will be a baby. So we already discussed what language the baby will learn before the baby born. So the agreement is we will teach the baby Cantonese. And some other day, we'll bring to learn Korean. They want to have three languages, well, probably French as well. So if you look at the future generation, look at language as a communication tool, it's very different. So based on this theory, Hong Kong has many grandfather, grandpa as well. They need Cantonese to communicate. So I don't see it will disappear right away, especially in industrial, in the business, if Cantonese maintain a influential in Hong Kong stock market, actually Hong Kong stock market use English. So I know a lot of Canadian young people go back to Hong Kong and work there because of an English skill. So that is important. So I think it's really, we look at the cultural, look at the business, to depends and see how the use of the language.
Address the issue of the decline of Cantonese language and the role of media in this issue. So we know that there are approximately 70 to 100 million speakers in the world, and it's kind of crazy to say that it may be endangered, like Cantonese as a language may be endangered, but from the linguist's point of view, the absolute number of speakers is not the only criterion for us to quantify the degree of endangerment. So I have pulled out this quote from Professor Stephen Matthews from Hong Kong U. So he said, Cantonese might survive for 50 years, but after 50 years, it might exist, but it's on the way out. And in the medium to long term, Cantonese is an endangered language. So you may think, what? 100 million speakers? So why do linguists say that? It's because when linguists quantify endangerment, we don't just look at this one factor, the absolute number of speakers, but we look at other factors, such as intergenerational language transmission. So among these 100 million speakers, how many of them are kids? Because we're thinking about 50 years down the road. We all die at some point. But it's a matter of whether we have new native speakers. That means the kids. So are the kids speaking the language? And we also have factors like existing language domains, like whether it's awkward to walk to a store and start a conversation in Cantonese, response to new domains and media, which is the theme of this panel, and materials for language education, governments' attitudes, and speakers' attitudes. So according to this UNESCO framework, we can give grades for each of these criteria. So intergenerational language transmission, so we can look at the case of Cantonese and try to match which descriptor can best describe the situation of Cantonese. So if we look at the scores for these criteria, the score is pretty low. It's around like 3 for Cantonese. But particularly for the criterion, new domains and media, that the score is still pretty high for the case of Hong Kong Cantonese because of these growing social media. So I would say that if we look at this framework, then new media is really the hope for revitalization of the language. And there are other cases to show that number of speakers does not tell us anything about the future of the language. For example, there's this paper from Cornell University about Javanese. So can a language with millions of speakers be endangered? And the answer is yes, because the kids are not speaking Javanese anymore. So when the older speakers pass away, then the kids will be speaking Indonesian, Bahasa Indonesian in general. So linguists look at this issue differently.
We'll take one last question from the back, and then I'll ask the panelists to wrap up. So. Thank you very much for the opportunity and also to for putting up the event. I basically have two comments. The first one is on why can't we write Cantonese. I have no background again in linguistics, but I believe there is a phenomenon in many Chinese languages called the separation of writing and speaking system, 文言分離. And Cantonese has a very long history of being separated in writing system and speaking system. So in the early like Republic of China kind of official documents, you see some written Cantonese elements, and also in Asian poems, a lot of those, we found that we can pronounce it in Cantonese better because Cantonese did preserve Asian tongues, and but they are written in written Cantonese, which seems more formal because it's traditional Chinese too. But the way we want to write down modern Cantonese is mostly like oral language with a lot of, we make up the characters with the mouse particle. And so, yeah, there might be an opportunity to create a new language, so for linguists to discuss. The second is on the future of Cantonese. I feel like the survival of a language is always a kind of a collective effort of force back and forth. So I'm from Guangzhou, and I definitely see when we feel that part of identity is pressured, then the kind of the resistance would come up too. So I would like to give some famous instance. The first one is kind of a localist movement calling to reflect on Cantonese culture, which is quite missing in the art scene, like art exhibition and so. And that was called Guangzhou Changnei, like Guangzhou supports you, Canton supports you. And that was used in one of the very famous instances, which a news commentator called Chen She, he's very famous in criticizing, making a like, 街坊新闻,新闻日日看, and then when he's somehow forced by the provincial government to leave the TV program from because feeling is too criticizing, that Guangzhou Changnei was used in the poster like featuring Chen She as like a Che Guevara style, and that poster was everywhere in Canton. That's kind of unimaginable because it's a source of civil resistance. So that was one. And also I feel like I'm a great fan of soccer, so I feel like the soccer game in Guangzhou, in Canton, is actually bringing young people more and more to use Cantonese, because when you sit in a 50,000 people stadium shouting for a team, although there's no Canton-based players in the team, you shout in Cantonese. That's a very good practice to feel proud and related to the language. And actually the team, although they are the investor of the team are not from Canton, they would use Canton slogans to attract more and more, and that become the city's new identity. They are deeply associated with the team called Guangzhou Dui. And also the naming of Canton Tower, because when it was built, it's rumored that it's almost certainly either named after Pearl River Tower or Guangzhou Tower. But in the end, after the voting, and that's very unusual, we did have a voting, and we voted Canton Tower. Also, I believe there's some sort of support in the government for sure for it to be done, but that's a good sign that seeing the government is recognizing that there is a huge need, also a huge resurgence of young people's thinking about this language is going to like this thing or like is having a pressure in that city.
Thank you for really interesting insights about Guangzhou. So before we close, maybe I'll just invite the panelists, if you want to, you don't have to, if you have a last takeaway to kind of leave us with food for thought. Anybody?
Yeah, I think there are a few elements that, would help us see whether, the Canton is going to go uphill or downhill. Of course, Beijing as the ruler of China, I think this is a very important factor. That also goes back to the leadership, whether the leadership is open-minded, confidence enough what kind of leadership style he is carrying. And the other thing is what kind of society China is heading. If it is going to a more open, liberal society, then I think we don't need to worry that much. But if it goes the opposite way, of course, well, there will be a lot of problems. The other thing, it's about entertainment. I think just like what Winnie said, and we also have other speakers said earlier as well. Say for me, even though sometimes when I go to buy DVD, those shop Hong Kong or China movie, there is always an option that, well, if you want to watch the Mandarin version, you have it. But if you want to watch a good Cantonese audio version, then you have to wait a bit. For me, well, usually a lot of movies, that's fine with me. But for Jiao Xingqi, it's a movie, I would only watch Cantonese. I can't imagine if I watch it in Mandarin. But of course, at the same time, I think Hong Kong or Cantonese-speaking entertainer, we need a little bit more, a lot more than Jiao Xingqi. And actually, if we have more, I think that really would help. And that also help, well, this is what I heard from people in mainland, that they think Cantonese, they think Hong Kong people, Hong Kong culture is cool. So this is from the street, and that's the coolness is still there, even though there are some not very good relations between the Hong Kong people and some of the visitors to Hong Kong in recent times. The last factor I think is also important is talking about overseas, the Cantonese situation. I think one thing we have to bear in mind that right now the major Chinese media are still owned and controlled by Cantonese-speaking owners, whether it's local owner or owner from Hong Kong.
Anybody else has any last takeaways?
I want to comment a little bit on your discussion about acquiring Chinese and it being in Mandarin. I think that it's...
I think that even, you know, even though I'm fourth generation, I feel like my soul is Cantonese because I can feel the laughter, the slang, all the culture that came from my grandparents and my father and everything else. But I know that, you know, I have a kind of linguistic schizophrenia because I acquired Mandarin. And when I went back to my home village, they would speak to me in Toisanwa, but I couldn't really speak in Toisanwa, so I would use Mandarin to speak to them because it was more formal and it was a way that I could actually, you know, talk to them. But my children, and I think that the institutional thing is very important, and maybe the institutional support is going to be on the outside as opposed to, you know, somewhere in China, because we didn't have the ability outside of the, you know, the sort of Chinatown Cantonese schools to acquire Cantonese in a formal way. So when I look at subtitles, I only look at subtitles and I think in Mandarin because that's how I learn them. If there is a Cantonese, formal Cantonese way of learning the characters, then I think that that's part of that culture and that revival. And if that's happening here, I think that that's actually a fantastic thing, because if we don't have those kind of supports, then my generation, the subsequent generations, there's no way that we could acquire that language anymore. And I guess it won't exist in China for very much longer.
To conclude my feeling in these 2 days and plus the Expo Asia, I think it's important for us in Canada to engage. Especially, I think yesterday I came and listened to the material and different perspective. Never have attended a discussion on Cantonese, but I think this gave me a very a good vision to think about our daily life and the language and also the culture we are using. So to finish it, I think we have the Cantonese skill. We like it. We use it.
And when we talk about the future of Cantonese, we think about different forces or pressure on the development of the language. So this pressure can come from the government, and it can come from the user. So if there are forces from the government, how can people counter that pressure? It's via social media. So it is really important in revitalization of the language. And we can also learn a lot about other Cantonese worlds through social media. So I encourage everybody to make good use of it. Yeah, thank you.
Liam, do you have a last one?
Sure. I feel like somebody mentioned earlier about observing trends in Hong Kong and Guangzhou sort of over a wall from our position here. I wonder if when we're talking about the death of Cantonese, I mean, maybe we're describing the death of Cantonese in Chinatowns, in heritage communities in North America, because there is such a phenomenon going on. And that has to do with the language policy, not in China, but here at home. So the language policy in Canada and the U.S. has been, for quite some time, preoccupied with assimilating and or educating new immigrants and dealing with the languages they bring with them as a sort of liability. There hasn't been enough work done on the interest that future generations down the line, second, third, fourth generation people have in reclaiming and or preserving their linguistic heritage. So we don't have a lot of resources to work with. If you go seeking out resources for learning Cantonese or rather for accessing services in Cantonese in Canada, it's mostly targeted at people for whom it is already a native language rather than people who might be interested in learning it but who were born here. So that's a gap that we might want to pay attention to.
Well, I want to thank everybody for a very vibrant discussion, and I think this is just the beginning. It's setting the stage for many, many more to come. So I see Henry waiting to...
I want to thank... So thank the panelists. And I also wanted to thank Helen and Leo and Hetty for organizing today's three wonderful sessions. And a special thank you to Denise Fong, who's there, for doing a lot of the logistics, and Alisa Leong and Angela He, who aren't here. So I hope all of you have seen that this is a space opening up. I mean, we always envisioned this as the beginning of a conversation, that things that came up in the last 2 days would be an opening to continue over the next few years. Just a couple things. Wing Chung Eng, his new book on Cantonese opera, you saw the poster. He will be here in July. So if you want to know about a book reading and talk that we're going to put together, do make sure that we have your email and that we can push it out to you through social media or listserv or some means. So Wing Chung Eng. We are also going to try to work on, in fact, bringing some folks from Hong Kong, perhaps Hong Kong Baptist University. Someone mentioned John Ernie and a few others who, it's a good time to be in Vancouver in July, so if you are around, we'll try to have some talks, so do look out for that, so do make sure that you are connected up with the Hong Kong Canada Crosscurrents and the Cantonese worlds sort of in terms of communication. But I know many things have come up. It's recorded, so we'll be putting it online as well. Look forward to seeing many of you over the next few years and continuing conversations, not just here, but also among our partner institutions, Simon Fraser University, University of Toronto, and as we actually work on, in fact, making more, having connections to other institutions across the other side of the Pacific. So thank you again, everyone, for coming, and feel free to keep milling about and asking questions, and but this does bring the formal conclusion to the two-day Cantonese Worlds Conference. Thank you again.